of the economy. And you take them through basic macroeconomics courses, you have land, labor, and capital, the primary factors of production. Land is kind of grayed out here because there's an assumption of almost perfect substitutability between these factors. You don't really need land or natural resources, just need more labor and capital, which are then combined to produce marketed goods and services as measured by GDP. GDP only covers things that are marketed. Then those goods and services are either consumed in the current period or reinvested to build more capital so you can have more consumption and production in the next period. So, you know, in this model, welfare is largely a function of consumption. The more consumption we consume, the better off we are. There's nothing in the vision that would constrain GDP from growing indefinitely. So there's this idea of infinite GDP growth. There's this idea of, you know, consumption is really the goal of the whole system. You can see this sort of vision being played out in many, many national policies going forward. But it's it doesn't apply anymore. We don't live in that world. If we ever live in that world, I'm not sure, but we live in now in a very full world, and that requires us to recognize that we are in a materially closed Earth system. Everything has to go somewhere. That there are these four basic types of assets. You can subdivide them, you know, further if you like, but this is one categorization that I think works. We have conventional built capital, we have human capital, individual people, so it's more than just their labor, it's really their intelligence, their information, their health, etc., as individuals. Then we have social capital, all of the interactions between people, formal and informal, all of our institutions and culture, etc. The market itself is a form of social capital. And then finally, natural capital. Everything else in the system that we didn't have to create, but that is a gift of nature. And recognizing that human well-being, well, all of these types of capital are required in a more balanced way to produce conventional goods and services, but also to produce human well-being more broadly defined, without ever going through the production, economic production part. And that human well-being is a much more complex function than simply the more we consume, the better off we are. It really depends on a whole range of factors, including, you know, how well this basic set of human needs is met. This goes back to Maslow's ideas, but more recently, Maslow's vaccine, and Barbara Nussbaum, and Margaret Sennett. And there are various lists here, but just to emphasize that it goes well beyond consumption and subsistence. Feel this subjective sense of well-being requires that we have security, affection, understanding, participation, leisure, spirituality, creativity, identity, freedom. So it's a much more complex set of basic human needs. There's been a lot of work recently on assessing subjective well-being, asking people, you know, how satisfied are you with your life? What we can do from a policy perspective, I think, is to create the opportunities for people to meet those needs, you know, to feel the sense of subjective well-being by how we arrange our assets, our built, our social, our human, our natural capital, and how we use our time. So, I think it's also important going forward to think of the health of systems in a more general way. Obviously, we want to create healthy systems at multiple scales, not just healthy ecosystems, but healthy economies, healthy individuals, etc. So one idea here has been this idea of ecosystem health, and how do we define a well-functioning system in a broader context. This is one definition from a book we did several years ago, that the system is healthy and free from distress syndrome, stable, sustainable, active, maintains its organization and autonomy over time, and is resilient to stress. This kind of definition could apply to any system at any scale. And the idea is that there's a balance of those characteristics that's really needed for a healthy system. Bigger metabolism, system has to have some energy flow and productivity in order to be healthy. It has to be organized, and I think this is more than just the diversity in the system, it's more than the number of parts that you have to work with, but how are those parts interrelated, how are they connected with each other, how is the system organized? And resilient, how does it respond to perturbation? And the lack of any one of those can lead to problems. If you have no resilience, you have a lot of vigor and organization, it can be a very brutal system subject to collapse. If you have a lot of vigor, a lot of productivity, a lot of resilience, but very poor organization, you can get a eutrophic situation. So eutrophic lakes, for example, have a lot of green algae that are producing very quickly, very resilient to change, but not really very organized, and therefore not very healthy in this context. So this also gets at the idea of ecological engineering. How do we design systems? How do we use this as an opportunity to design systems that are healthy, that contribute to human well-being, but also to the well-being of the rest of nature? And ecological engineering has been defined as the design of sustainable ecosystems that integrate human society with its natural environment for the benefit of both. So this is not anthropocentric or ecocentric, but it's more of a holistic systems view of how the system functions and how we can design a system that allows humanity to be a sustainable part of it. Now this may be, and it may be in italics there, they may be novel assemblages of species that perform desired functions and produce a range of services. And I don't think this idea of a novel ecosystem is indefinable or undefined. I think it just means a new assemblage that we haven't seen before. It recognizes that managing the system at any scale requires an effective interplay between science and professional judgment. So it is sort of like health professionals in the health field. You have to have an understanding of how the body works, but you also have to exercise some professional judgment. They're complex adaptive systems that must be understood and managed as such, and they produce a range of valuable services that support human health and human well-being. So, and this idea of novel ecosystems, I think, is relevant here. Because our traditional approaches to managing these ecosystems have been very much restore them to some previous state. So I think we need to take a more holistic view, and that in fact there are several authors who are suggesting that we have to, that our goal is to preserve nature in its pristine pre-human state, something we need to sort of get beyond. And we come to see this how we actually can create a fuller relationship with the rest of nature. So, what our conservation objectives need to be in the Anthropocene under changing climate conditions, etc. We need to refocus our goals, I think, for creating a better world for both ourselves and the rest of nature, recognizing our increasing interdependence, and focus on creating and maintaining healthy systems at multiple scales rather than preserving an idealized past. And this may require both the protection of existing systems and the design of novel ecosystems that are better adapted to novel conditions. And I'll repeat this, I guess, several times. We need to get beyond the either-or kind of debate that in many of these situations, it's really both. It's not thinking of our previous approaches to biodiversity conservation as being wrong and ecosystem services being right, or the reverse. They're both particular tools that we can use to help design a sustainable and desirable future. Ecosystem services, then, I think is an important concept to help in that regard. The benefits that people derive from functioning ecosystems. And this is the Millennium Ecosystem Assessment Diagram, which you've seen before, that categorizes these services into these four broad groups: provisioning, regulating, cultural, and supporting services, and their connections to human well-being. However, I think there's some important things missing from this diagram, and that's the interaction with the other three forms of capital that I talked about. Ecosystem services don't just flow from natural systems into creating sustainable well-being. They require the interaction with the other three types of capital that I mentioned, built, our human, our social capital. And when we talk about the value of ecosystem services, we're talking about the relative contribution of natural capital in interaction with these other forms to create well-being, sustainable well-being. So this goes well beyond conventional market-based approaches. And I think there are some mistaken identities concerning ecosystem services and valuation that need to be pointed out. First of all, economics is not just the market. The market is just one institution that we designed to help allocate resources. But it's not what economics should be all about. Although, unfortunately, often it is sort of conveyed in that way, studied in that way. But economics really should be how we manage the system to meet our goals, which, as I said, are changing and need to be brought to sustainable well-being. Valuation is not about privatization or commodification or trading of these services. In fact, the whole point of ecosystem services is that they're non-market, they're outside the market. They contribute to well-being in other, more direct ways, but they don't necessarily, they're not valuable because of their exchange value, they're valuable because of their use and their non-use values outside the market. And that expressing these values in monetary units is not the same as market or exchange value. It's just a way to communicate that relative contribution to well-being to particular audiences. You could equally well express those values in energy units, or land units, or time units, or any other common denominator. So it's really a question of what communicates best, rather than making the assumption that because you're talking about monetary units, you're talking about exchange values. Those are not the same thing. This valuation of ecosystem services and natural capital, I think, has several potential uses, including simply raising awareness and interest. Just making it clear that these services and nature are much more important to supporting well-being than had been previously assumed. Often decisions are made as if those values are zero, if they are meaningless. So just raising awareness, I think, is an important contribution. Revising national income and well-being accounts. We mistakenly pursue GDP as a national policy goal. We'll get more into this in a bit. We need to broaden our measures of well-being as well as and do national economy that includes that. There's a range of specific policy analyses these guys can contribute to: urban and regional land use plan, payment for ecosystem services, full cost accounting, and the idea of common asset trust. And as I said, Dr. Kubiszewski this afternoon will give more details of some of these applications. I put out the common asset trust idea because I think we need different kinds of institutions to manage these ecosystem services, which are usually public goods. They're not private goods. Market institutions are not the best way to manage them. But we can think of this idea of a common asset trust, watershed trust, atmospheric trust, oceanic trust. How do we conceive of these assets as belonging to all of us collectively, and it needs to be managed to maintain the value of the asset rather than to simply harvest resource. So there's been increasing academic interest in this topic of ecosystem services. If you go into Scopus and type in ecosystem services in the topic field, you get this plot of the number of articles published on ecosystem services over time. I think Dan talked about at least the early paper back in 1984, and the Western paper was back here a little bit further. And the Gretchen Daily and the paper we did in 1997. Since then, it's been exponential growth, so that now there are more than 2,000 papers annually published on ecosystem services. This is when the Millennium Ecosystem Assessment came in, as Ecosystem Services Partnership for Economics of Ecosystems and Biodiversity, and IPDES, Intergovernmental Panel on Biodiversity and Ecosystem Services. Ida will talk more about those later. But this paper was one, I think, got things going in terms of, again, creating interest in this idea. And this was a synthesis project, one of the first workshops that was done at the National Center for Ecological Analysis and Synthesis at Santa Barbara, where we got together and said, well, let's look at all the studies that have been done so far on a list of 17 different ecosystem services across 16 different biomes, and we sort of put them all together in this meta-analysis and came up with an overall estimate of between 16 and 54 trillion a year, averaging about 33 trillion. Significantly larger than GDP at the time. But a lot of these services occur outside the market. They're not marketed goods and services, they're public goods. One thing we didn't control was what they put on the cover of the magazine. They said pricing the planet. We didn't really mean pricing the planet. We meant dying the planet. And I think there's a very important distinction in there. Economists are famous for knowing the price of everything and the value of nothing. In fact, what we're trying to do is to bring in the value of these services, how do they contribute to well-being, not necessarily how they're exchanged in market situations. Since then, as part of the TEAP study and all those extra thousands of papers that have published, there's been a lot more work on the value of these various systems from various perspectives, and this is just a summary of the results of that new synthesis in terms of the unit values that be expressed in terms of the average or the range of values per hectare per year, and you get some very big numbers. I don't know if you can see that. You can fit out folks, but coral reefs in particular and coastal ecosystems are in the hundreds of thousands of US dollars per hectare per year in terms of their contribution to well-being. More recently, we did an estimate of the changes in those values from the 1997 estimate to more recently, in 2011, based on land use changes and changes in these unit values. And as I said, I will give you a little more about the details of how we did the study, but the bottom line is we estimated a loss over that time period because of land use change, because of loss of coral reefs, loss of tropical forests, some of the more valuable ecosystems are being converted into less valuable ecosystems. We lost about $20 trillion a year. It's larger than the GDP of the United States. But again, this is an outside the market system. We know that when we make these kinds of land use transitions, this again is from the Millennium Ecosystem Assessment, when you convert from intact wetlands to intensive farming, there's a net loss of more than half of the social value of the system. You're increasing the private value, the marketed value. You're losing all of the other ecosystem services. Likewise, for several other land use transitions. A few years ago, we tried to estimate the benefit-cost ratio for conserving and restoring our natural capital assets globally. And we used a scenario that involved increasing the reserve network to cover 15% of the terrestrial biosphere, 30% of the marine biosphere. That would cost around $45 billion a year at the time. But the benefits of doing that would be the difference between the intact system and what it might be converted to. That net value is about $4 to $5 trillion. So the benefit-cost ratio of 100 to 1, I would say, conservatively estimated. I challenge you to find a better investment these days. But again, this is a social investment. This is benefiting society. It's not benefiting necessarily any private industry, which is one of the reasons it hasn't happened yet. But I think that's the challenge. How do we create institutions that can help us manage these systems in a way that can actually capture the social benefits of doing this kind of conservation plan? The only better investment I could find was for oil companies investing in political campaigns in the United States. Anyway, ultimately, I think we need to understand better the complex dynamics of these systems over time, over space, and there's been some work in that direction, creating integrated models that cover both natural systems and human systems and nervous systems. This is just one example. The results from this kind of model just show that, show that the contribution of ecosystem services to human well-being is even a larger fraction or compared to the GDP than we get when we're static kind of benefit transfer analysis. There's been a whole agenda on landscape modeling that is also integrating across the biophysical and the human system components, and they can better get at these ecosystem services and how they contribute to well-being in time and space. And I mentioned this this model of the Maya civilization already as a way to use these models in very innovative ways to understand what's happened in the past and what could happen in the future. We are working toward this sort of generalizable approach, something we call multi-scale integrated models of ecosystem services that could be applied anywhere from small watersheds to whole regions, whole states, up to the global scale. That include all of the interacting components that are necessary to understand how these systems function and also how they contribute to well-being over time and space. And finally, I think it's important to make these sorts of models more accessible. And one way of doing that is to put some engaging game kind of interfaces on top of it. So we've been working on developing game interfaces for these underlying landscape models that can then be used for a range of purposes, including better understanding how people value these different services, what kind of trade-offs are they going to make in the game environment, how do they learn about ecosystem services by playing the game, et cetera. So you might call it an effort to build integrated games. Right now, I've been told that we spend about 3 billion hours a week weaving humanity playing computer games before Pokemon Go came out, so it's probably even more than that. So how can we get some small fraction of that time spent to play games that we can use for research about ecosystem services? And that also can help educate the general public about what these services are, how they contribute to well-being, etc. So we're working on along those lines. And it's also important to talk about the connection or the influence of ecosystem services in national accounting and build different kinds of accounting systems. So this is just one paper that looked at a range of variables and how they contribute to life satisfaction globally. And it's possible to predict the variation in life satisfaction from this range of variables, many of which have to do with natural capital and not so much just GDP. So, the conclusion is concerning ecosystem services, I'll point out, that this is increasingly useful to highlight, measure, and value the degree of interdependence between humans and the rest of nature. So it's not totally anthropocentric, it's not totally ecocentric, it's really a systems view. It's complementary with other approaches to nature conservation, but it gives some additional conceptual and empirical tools that the others lack in communicating with different audiences for different purposes. This estimates of global accounting value expressed in monetary units are mainly useful to raise awareness about the magnitude of these services relative to other services. But one should not underestimate the importance of this change in awareness and worldview that these global estimates can facilitate. So it's kind of a precursor to more practical applications at different scales. Okay. And this concept allows us, I think, to build a more comprehensive and balanced picture of the assets that support human well-being and human interdependence with the well-being of all life on the planet. Okay, that's the natural capital side of this. And I'll spend a little time now about the social capital side, which I think is equally important, and with some discussion of how we can put those pieces together and what it means. This is from a book by Richard Wilkinson and Kate Pickett called The Spirit Level, where they look at the relationship between income inequality in a country and this whole range of social problems, including homicide, imprisonment, obesity, etc. And there's a very strong relationship. The United States is way up here, Scandinavia is down here. The more unequal society is, the harder it is to build social capital to have a high quality of life. This is an experiment that was done in the United States where they asked 5,000 Americans what they thought the wealth distribution in the country was. And they got this distribution. They thought the top 20% owned a little more than 50% of the wealth in the country. The actual distribution looks more like this. The top 20% owned more than 80% of the wealth. Then they also asked them what they would like it to be, and they got this plot. So they would like the wealth distribution to be much more equal than it really is. So they need it more equal than what they thought it was. We know that it's possible to reduce wealth inequality over time. In fact, we were doing that in all of these developed countries from the end of World War II until about 1980. And we used progressive tax rates and several other policies to do that. So it's certainly not impossible to turn that around. What happened here is that Ronald Reagan and Margaret Thatcher were elected on the sort of neoliberal economic agenda, reducing taxes on the wealthy. We are now back to income inequality rates in the United States. They're as bad as they were in the late 1920s, before the Great Depression. Brazil, I think, also has very high rates of income inequality. So this has a big impact on well-being and different other aspects of it. This is a similar plot across the U.S. states, not quite as strong a relationship, but nevertheless very important relationships between income inequality and quality of life and social capital. So this is from a study by Robert Putnam in 2000 called Bowling Alone, and he used participation in different kinds of social clubs, including bowling leagues, participation in voting, to create an index of social capital, how much do people participate in their community. And you can see there's quite a variation across the different states in the U.S. Anybody know what state this is? No. This is where Las Vegas is. This is Nevada. Zero social capital. There is a strong relationship then between the higher the social capital, the lower the murder rate by state, the lower the TV watching by fourth and eighth graders, the higher the health index, the higher the educational index. It has a very significant impact on a whole range of factors that contribute to well-being. We also know that if you plot GDP per capita against life satisfaction, that is from these surveys of life satisfaction around the world, you get this sort of relationship, very strong trend at the beginning, but beyond about $10,000 per capita a year, not much of a relationship at all. So there are many other factors that contribute to well-being. And Costa Rica has as high life satisfaction as the USA, with a third of the GDP per capita. So a lot depends on how that GDP is distributed. A lot depends on how other aspects of the system are dealt with, how our natural capital is dealt with in particular. And we know that GDP was never designed as a measure of societal well-being. It only measures marketed income, production and consumption of marketed goods and services. It's not even a measure of sustainable incomes. What we need to move towards is a better measure of what you might call economic welfare, which at least subtracts the things that we don't want more of. If there's an oil spill, somebody has to go clean it up. That's going to contribute to more GDP. There's more crime, there's more pollution. In general, GDP goes up. So it's not necessarily what we want. We want a higher quality of life, and that's sustainable. So there have been some attempts to measure economic welfare. I think we can go beyond that and say, well, we really want to measure human welfare. Subjective well-being might be one way to get at that. But the point of the economy, which should be to create as much welfare for at least cost. And GDP is really measuring the cost of that for us, for the minimum amount of GDP. So it's, I think it's well past time to leave GDP behind as a policy goal, as a national policy goal. And there have been several alternatives put on the table, and we grouped them in that paper into these three basic categories of having modifying GDP, things that could be expressed in a monetary unit, surveys of well-being, like the World Value Survey that plot was based on. Bhutan has something called gross national happiness. They do surveys of people's well-being. And then there's a range of indicators that are based on several indicators that are put together into an index over time. It might be the Human Development Index, the Happy Planet Index. I'll talk a little bit about the OECD Better Life Index, which just came out. I know you can't see any of the words on this, but this is from the World Happiness Report, which just came out. So this is a certain, these are life satisfaction scores averaged across all the countries in the world. The one at the top is Denmark. Brazil is here. The interesting thing was they tried to explain the variation in these life satisfaction scores with these other variables, including the yellow part is explained by GDP or consumption. So it's only a small fraction of the variation in life satisfaction. The other factors they looked at were social support, life expectancy, freedom to make life choices, generosity, etc. So many of the things that we're talking about in that list of basic human needs are things that help explain variation in life satisfaction. The blue part is all the unexplained variation. And I think what they left out of this study was the contribution of natural capital and ecosystem services. The OECD Better Life Index is an interesting one. It's got a very nice website where they look at the 11 different factors, including housing, income, jobs, community, but also civic engagement, environment, life satisfaction, safety, work-life balance. And they have these flower diagrams that show the contribution of those various things. If they're all weighted equally, you get this distribution across the OECD countries. Australia actually is at the top of the list. But you can go into the website and you can change the weighting of these different factors. And then you can see how that affects the ranking of the different countries. And they're actually collecting that data of how people weight those different factors. So that should be interesting. This is another one that we've worked with called the Genuine Progress Indicator, based on the Index of Sustainable Economic Welfare that Herman Daly and John Cobb came up with. This is interesting because it can be compared with GDP over time. It starts with personal consumption expenditures, which are a major component of GDP, but then it weights them by income distribution. So it takes into account the fact that if GDP is more equitably distributed, that creates more welfare, and if it's inequitably distributed. It adds a few things that are left out, the value of household labor and volunteer work, good things, but they're not part of GDP because they're not marketed. And it subtracts a bunch of things that shouldn't be counted as positives. The cost of crime, family breakdown, underemployment, loss of leisure time, a whole range of things that are part of the natural capital component. The cost of water and air pollution, the loss of wetlands and non-renewable resources, etc. It gets some really interesting results when you apply this. For the United States, you get GDP per capita doing this from 1950 until not that recently, 2005 or so. GPI tracked it fairly well until about 1980 and then leveled off and has been slightly declining over time. So when you start incorporating the cost of that GDP growth, the cost in terms of social capital, income inequality, the cost in terms of environmental destruction, there's no net gain at all. We haven't had a growing, in a genuine way, economy for decades now. And I think people are beginning to pick up on that. Here's another way of looking at it and compared with some other indicators. Some recent papers that we did with my colleague, Tom Wader. So if you look at the changes, this is GDP per capita in the US, GPI tracks it fairly well until about 80 and levels off. The ecological footprint has been per capita, has been relatively stable, but the biocapacity has been increasing, and life satisfaction has also been decreasing over time. Look at this number. So again, these are indices. With 100 in 1980, U.S. goes up to about 160. If you look at China, it goes up over 350, which is, I think, the time is. So GDP has been going through the roof, but GPI, the red line, tracked it until about 1995, and then has also been stable ever since then. So all of the air and water pollution in China, et cetera, has canceled out that growth in GDP in terms of well-being. Recently, we looked at all the countries for which GDP had been estimated. There were 17 countries around the world that had studies done of their GPI per capita over time. And from that, we created a global GPI per capita estimate, which is this purple one. Compare that with GDP per capita globally. And you get this fact that we've gone from a period of economic growth where the economy was growing and was actually increasing well-being in the post-war period, until about 1980, to a period of uneconomic growth. So since then, the economy has continued to grow, but our well-being has been flat or decreasing globally. So there are a couple of states in the U.S. that have picked up on this GPI, Maryland and Vermont in particular, are employing the GPI as one of their decision-making, at least they were under the former governor. I'm not sure if this is continuing under the current governor. I already talked about this. So, I'll wrap up with a couple of other points. And this cartoon just shows the guy in the back of the room. He's always skeptics. The guy in the back of the room saying, yes, yeah, but what if it's a big hoax and we create this better world for nothing? So I think the point is that we need to focus much more on creating a better world. What does that goal look like? How do we begin to measure progress toward that better world? How do we incorporate the value of natural and social capital into that assessment? And ultimately, how do we break our addiction to this growth at all costs economic paradigm and to overconsumption? And I think that's maybe a productive way of thinking of it. Why are we not getting more progress? You know, we've known these things for decades, literally. But nothing has really changed. So one way of looking at it is that we are, in a very real sense, addicted to the system. It's got very strong positive feedbacks in the short run. But in the long run, it's going to kill us. So what can we learn? One idea is, what can we learn from what works at the individual scale to overcome addiction? How can we apply that to what could work at the societal scale? How do we do societal therapy? And we've got a paper that's coming out soon that makes this analogy between motivational interviewing, which seems to be a process that works well at the individual scale. The worst thing you can say to an addict at the individual scale is, you're doing the wrong thing, you're just going to kill yourself, you've got to stop doing this. That immediately gets a very defensive denial kind of reaction. And yet that's exactly the way we're framing a lot of these environmental issues to society. So it's not surprising, perhaps, that we get this kind of denial. Motivational interviewing takes a different approach. It says, how do we engage the addict in the discussion of their life goals? Is what they're doing now really helping them achieve their life goals or not? And if not, then how to try to make plans and changes in their life to better achieve what they're at. So I think the analogy for that at the societal scale is to engage society in thinking about the kind of world that we really want. How do we describe this sustainable and desirable future? This is a book that we put out recently that's a collection of essays that ask just that question. What would this world look like? And how do we get this broader discussion among society about how what that world might look like? We're doing, in Australia right now, we have done a survey where we put forward four different alternative futures. One is kind of the business as usual, free enterprise future. One is the what we call the community well-being future, kind of a version of the sustainable development goals being implemented, and a couple of other alternatives. And we ask them to read about these futures and then take a survey and rank, which we should prefer. So, maybe not so surprisingly, the vast majority of the respondents prefer the community well-being future that's more based on, you know, we're all in this together, inequality is addressed, that governance is at many levels, and all the whole sort of kind of sustainable system that we can think about. But we also asked them where they thought the country was headed and where it is now. I thought it was very much in the free enterprise scenario and very much headed towards the free enterprise scenario. So the country was headed towards a direction that nobody really wanted to go in. And I think bringing that sort of conversation up to the whole societal level can really have a positive impact and help to begin this therapy that we need to make the transition. So, what would that world look like? This is a list of maybe the 12 things that we need to change to create this better world, to make this transition. We need new means and measures of success. So we need to go well beyond GDP as a measure of success to GPI or even beyond that, something that is a better measure of overall societal well-being. We need the limits on materials, energy, waste, and land use to stay within planetary boundaries. We need more meaningful prices. You know, the market lies to us about the price of everything because it's leaving out the external costs, external environmental and social costs. We need more durable and repairable products. Fewer status goods. Much of our consumption and overconsumption is an arms race for status, which is not really necessary. We can reduce that and focus more on things that are more community-oriented services, like ecosystem services. More informative advertising. advertising that really tells us what products do, and don't try to make us unhappy and consume more. Better screening of technology. Technology is a good servant for master. It means to say what kind of technology will help us achieve our goals rather than just anything. More efficient capital stock as well. This is kind of the parallel of the more efficient short-term goods. More local and less global. And this is not just to reduce the costs of transport, but because we know that local economies support communities and can help build social capital. And can support well-being more directly. So if you're only measuring GDP, that looks good to have trade agreements and lots of international trade. If you're focused more on well-being, then it's not such a great idea because it does have negative impacts on community well-being. So if we focus on well-being, I think we're going to get a different set of trade relations. Reduce inequality. We spend a lot of time talking about that. In order to build social capital, we need to have a much more equal distribution of wealth and resources. Less work and more leisure. Most people do not object to this goal. But I think it's extremely important. We need to recognize and have a better work-life balance and also recognize that work is something that should be rewarded and not just something that we do to make money to buy stuff that we really don't necessarily need. And finally, education for life and not just for work. So education, again, builds human capital, it builds social capital, it contributes directly to well-being without necessarily going through the consumption of what you get from having a job. So finally, I think we need some venues for having this ongoing discussion. We created this journal called Solutions that's devoted to discussing, publishing the things that are working around the world. And in fact, this world that I'm talking about is not a fantasy. It actually is occurring. It's just not all occurring in the same place. So you know that most of these solutions really are feasible. They just need to be put together. So take a look at the website here. Our rule of thumb for papers and solutions are that no more than a third of the paper can be about describing the problem, and two-thirds is about describing the solution. We have one hard copy with me if you want to take a look, but it's all available for free online. Okay, and thank you very much.